The next speaker we have is Paul Schukens from the Catholic University of Leuven and Tilburg University. And he will present today a paper on platform work and its regulatory effects for social security. So Paul, the floor is yours, and we are very much looking forward to your presentation.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Lars. It's a pleasure, and thank you very much for the invitation to come to Bremen. It was very nice to hear it's a young university, slightly younger than I am. But it was very nice to hear that everything started with social sciences here. And although I'm a lawyer, my work as social law brings me to cooperate quite a lot in Leuven and Tilburg, but also beyond that with social scientists. I mean, we are a bit interlinked. And the fact that interdisciplinary research is so important in Bremen shows that it's no coincidence that you invited me to come over here, because again, social security law is very much interdisciplinary. When I prepared my contribution today, I reckoned, well, this is the last one in a series of contributions this year on platform work and social security. But the difference is that in most of the previous sessions, those people were experts in social security and not so much in platform work. And I think now it's a bit vice versa. So if I will become too technical, I will see it. but if you if it's hard to follow in the technicalities, let me know. I will try to stay away from too technical things in social security. Now, this speech is a little bit into a broader setting, broader research, which we are conducting in Leuven, University of Leuven in Belgium, in Flanders, and University of Tilburg. And I have to say that much of the content is also being provided by a younger researcher, Alberto Barrio, and a slightly less younger researcher, Saskia Montebovi, who are not here today. And I'm simply presenting some of the research results and some more general reflections. But do know that quite a lot of the work is done by them in Tilburg, and some part of the work is done in Leuven. Now, what is very much at stake is the following. Platform work, so platforms and people working in platforms, are very often labeled as atypical, non-standard work. They are something special. They deviate from the normal worker, apparently. Is that problematic? Yes, it is. In labor law and social security law, much of the laws and the systems, and I think Germany is a very good example of that too, much of the protection which has been designed for pensions, for instance, or for unemployment or for working capacity, it has been designed around the worker and especially the traditional worker. And platform workers are labeled to be atypical, non-standard, non-traditional. And to some extent, it has been mentioned already before, with the first presentation, the reference was made, they are freelancers, they are self-employed, and there you have it already. I mean, when I started my own PhD 25 years ago, I worked upon self-employment and social protection. And back then, self-employed people, the traders, the craftsmen, the farmers, they were labeled to be atypical for social security, which I always had difficulties with, because in my opinion, they were very typical self-employed. But from a social point of view, they were atypical because the protection law, the labor law protection, social security law protection, was traditionally designed with the traditional worker, the 9-to-5 person. And as soon as you deviate from that default situation, from the traditional worker, you run into problems, especially with labor law, but also with social protection law. And now we are 25 years later, and I notice that in the European Union, they refer to self-employment as typical and platform as atypical. And 25 years ago, self-employment was atypical too. So my first thing I would like to focus upon a little bit is, what is typical work and what is atypical work? And what is then the issue? What is the problem for platform work? Why are they atypical concerned to the typical ones? So this may sound a little bit theoretical, but it's not so much theoretical, as you will see. And that standard work, that typical work, and I will use standard work and typical work and atypical work and non-standard work as kind of synonyms. I know that you can make some distinctions, but I use them as a synonym. That standard work is undergoing some challenges. Due to the digitalization of work, due to the robotization of work, due to the flexibilization of work, standard work is undergoing quite some impact of our societies. And work is not done in the same way, let's say, than 25 or 50 years ago. And I would like also to to draw your attention to that. And then I will come to the case of platform work, and especially in Tilburg University, we're focusing very much upon the social protection of platform workers in a comparative perspective. We compare some systems. Are they protected? How are they protected? And what are the issues when you protect them for unemployment, for working capacity, for pensions, for healthcare? And that's the last one. That's if you see that whole evolution, and if we focus upon platform work, what are the upcoming challenges for regulating social security? It's pretty much now in the attention. It's very much in the attention, social protection again, and access to social protection. The European Union Commission, and actually the European Union as such, launched a recommendation. I know legally speaking it's rather soft, but still it's a recommendation on the access to social protection, and they are demanding the states, like Germany, but also other states, to pay enough effort that atypical work forms like platform work, but also self-employment, can have access to the major schemes of social security, including unemployment. If you looked at the first version of their draft, it was even so that they were demanding that self-employed would have access on a mandatory basis to schemes like unemployment. I don't know how that would have been welcomed in Germany, but it was very welcomed in a very cool way in the Netherlands. They did not like the idea at all. The last version is now, it's a recommendation, and they call upon member states to do the necessary efforts to envisage the possibility to give them, at least on a voluntary basis, access to unemployment. So we shifted a little bit from first mandatory to voluntary and so on. But still, it's very high on the agenda of the European Union. It was very high on the agenda of Commissioner Juncker and Commissioner Thijssen to do something about the atypical workers, because indeed they are growing. If you look at the Netherlands and the UK, the amount of people who are working in atypical way, like self-employed way, but also platform work is among them, it's exploding. In the Netherlands, it exploded. That was part of a very deliberate policy to have as many as possible people at work, if possible in a flexible manner, but not on unemployment, and give them access to self-employment, to give them access in an easy way to platform work. But they did not always think, are we going to protect them for pensions and working capacity? There the idea, well, we will see, it's an issue for later. But it's not an issue for later, it's an issue for today. So if we don't take action today, the problem will only grow. So that's a bit, traditionally, because it's not the first time I'm giving this contribution, it has been evolving. Traditionally, I always start with this slide. Actually, it's this slide. It's an old, I mean, if you see the figures, it's from 2014, but it doesn't matter because it didn't change so much. Well, the first time I presented was 3 years ago, it was 59%, now it's 58% of the people in the active working population is working as a standard worker in a typical way. So the sheer majority is still working in a normal way. And the minority is working in an atypical way in the European Union. Well, so far the good news, depending on whether you think it's good or not, maybe a bit more concerning is that the number went down of typical workers and the number of atypical workers went up. And I'm not going to dive into too much into details. Well, first of all, I would like to draw your attention to the traditional atypical work forms. It's people working part-time, apparently that's the biggest group, and then people working on fixed-term contracts for 1 month or for 1 year, but then they don't know what will happen afterwards. And then the ones working as a self-employed, so they are not in a subordinated relationship with their commission, with their employer. Now, if you add the percentages all together, you will go beyond 100%, and you will think, okay, we have again a lawyer in front of us not able to count properly. This is deliberately done. Do know that some of the atypical work forms are combinations. They work both part-time and fixed-term. And if you do it in that way, you come to 100%, so be reassured. But there are some evolutions, I don't know them by heart, but at least, I mean, for instance, in the US, the growth of employment the last 20 years was mainly due to and thanks to atypical work forms. The number of young people starting to work is going down on the basis of a traditional undefinite work labor contract. So more and more young workers, when they start to work, it's on atypical work forms. If you look at the Netherlands, the number of people working in an atypical manner, part and whatever, it's almost, well, it's one-third, something like one-third of the working population, even more if you see some surveys. especially women there work very often part-time. But then I have to say immediately, in the Netherlands they will say it immediately, that a large group of those part-time workers in the Netherlands, they do it on a voluntary basis. They like to work part-time, it's their wish. So you have to be careful with part-time, it's not always a negative thing, sometimes it's considered to be positive, well, it's how you look at it. Self-employment is rather stable. If you look at the figures for 25, 30 years, 16% of the active work population in the European Union is 16% already for 25, 30 years. So no big movements there. But there you have to be careful. I mean, the number of self-employed with employees, that the small, medium-sized enterprises, and very often that's considered to be something positive. Eh? That you start as a self-employed person, and the self-employed activity grows, and it becomes a smaller company, a bigger company, it becomes a multinational. That's what we want, eh? That's to some extent, well, at least when you see some policymakers. The number of self-employed with wage earners went down, and the number of solo self-employed, as they call self-employed on their own without employees, in the Netherlands they call them ZZP, self-employed without employees, it grew. And very often those self-employed, they're not always the lawyers or the architects, but it are more and more freelancers. It are the group of self-employed which are not very well regulated. They simply earn some income, not as a wage earner, they're a freelancer, and that group grew enormously. And many platform workers do belong to that group of solo self-employed. It's not completely sure, but very often. So there are, I mean, behind those percentages, I mean, there are some other realities taking place. Now, typical work, and where did I get the figures from? It was from the EU Labour Survey, it's from statistical data from the European Union. And typical was there always defined as work which is indefinite full-time employment. So it's workers working full-time and on the basis of an indefinite work contract, so without knowing when it will stop from the beginning, and not as a self-employed. But apart from that, because that's statistically, full-time or typical work is also a kind of standard for regulations, for labor law and social security. As I explained in the beginning, much of our labor laws and social security laws have been designed around a typical worker. But who is then the typical worker? Who is that standard? Who is that default then? What was the kind of reference when we were designing our labor law and later on social protection law? Now there I think a very nice definition, apart from the ILO, is a definition we once found by Walton. He's a judge from Australia, where I think he pretty much covered the original idea of the standard worker, which was the reference in our societies. And he defined it as a stable, and I liked very much in the beginning that reference to stability, it was also mentioned on the platform workers as in the first contribution. It's a stable relationship, and stable is the outcome, I will come back to that later. It's a stable relationship which is open-ended, so when it begins we don't know when it will stop, and hopefully it will end for the rest of my life. Direct employment relationship, so you have one employer, one employee, and they have a contract, so it's not a triangular relationship like you often have in platform work, where you have a kind of intermediary, a platform, and then somebody asking for a task or service and then somebody doing it. That comes close to agency work, and then you have triangular relations. We don't like it so often in labor law, because then we don't know who is the employer, who is giving the instructions. It's complicating things. In other parts of our life, triangular relations may also complicate sometimes things. So it's a direct employment relationship between one employer and employee, between a dependent, the one who's doing the job is depending upon the employer, and depending in two layers. He gets instructions, so that's the legal dependency. The boss, the employer, is giving instructions how you should do it and when you should do it. But it's also economically depending upon the employer, because his main income is coming from that employer. So economically, he's depending upon his commissioners. Full-time, so that's clear, eh? And it's unitary, again, it's referring to that unitary employer session. Now, I put that a little bit in this chart, eh, where you see then the typical, and the lawyers will immediately, especially labor lawyers, will immediately see the typical elements of a typical labor relationship. The worker is in subordination, the bilateral contract, he gets a salary, income for work, work for income, that's the kind of exchange, the market exchange, which in the contract, the economic dependency, the mutuality of obligations, I work for your income, you give me income because I work, it's interlinked. And the work is usually performed at the employer's premises. I will come back to that immediately. Self-employment is deviating from that because it's not impersonal subordination. They're free. They are their own boss. They don't get instructions from their... And they're traditionally not economically depending upon their employer because they have many clients. So if I don't do the job for you, I go to another client. And the least clients they have, the more depending they come to their commissioner. And then they come close to the workers, to the wage earners. That's the economic dependency. And they don't have a salary, they have an income, self-employed. So the self-employed, they are deviating from most of the elements in the employment relationship. But the stability is also important. The indefinite duration and the full-time employment give stability to the worker in the first place. He knows that every month or every week or whatever, he will get an income, and he hopes that it will go on until he does not want to go on anymore, then he will move on. But he hopes it will go on. It's indefinite. So that's the stability element. But the stability is two-sided. The stability is two-sided. It's not only for the wage earner, it's also for the employer. Because if you have happy employees, then you know that you can rely upon them. So the loyalty, the trust, and you can go on with them, and you will train them, and you will invest into them, and it's a kind of two ways. And that was the idea of Ford, that he was actually the company Ford producing the Ford Model T and so on. He was very much backing up this kind of idea. If you give them enough stability and reliability, they earn income, and they will buy your products, your cars, your Ford T, and so on. So it was a kind of two-sided stability which was created both for the employee and the employer. And if you're looking at part-time work, for instance, and work which is only fixed term, it's deviating from that stability, income stability or time stability, and then you have the two other major atypical work forms. And what we have been undergoing, especially in the UK and the Netherlands, but I would say largely in Europe, was more flexibilization, going away from those full-time indefinite and going away to some extent from that stability, from that loyalty and so on, create more flexibility in the labor relationship. So if you deviate from those charts, you're dealing with the traditional atypical work forms. And I put them in those circles, part-time, fixed-term, self-employment and so on. Those were traditionally already for 30 years, 40 years, they main atypical work forms deviating from typical work. And that had consequences. To give you, for instance, in Social Security, one or two examples where you will immediately understand what it's about. For instance, self-employment. Traditionally, we say self-employment, we don't cover them or we don't protect them for unemployment, for the risk of unemployment. Why would we? Because the risk of unemployment is based very much upon the relationship between the employer and the employee. It is the employer sacking you. So a lot of our conditions is looking at why did he fire you? What is the reason that you are on the street now? It's based upon the relationship between you as an employee and an employer. But as a self-employed does not have an employer, you cannot protect them for unemployment. That was traditionally the idea why self-employed were not protected for unemployment. Same for part-time work. Well, part-time work, your income will be part-time, and that can create problems, for instance, for your building up of your pension. Suddenly your income is lower, the number of hours you have been working is lower, your pension record will be less developed compared to a full-time, and your pension will be, in the end of the day, potentially low, maybe lower than a social or a minimum pension. And then suddenly you see that states made corrections and were saying, okay, for part-time work, we will do some extras, we will count more their hours so that their pension will be higher. So they were had to correct. Why? Because they started from the traditional worker, full-time and so on. So if you deviate from that traditional thing, you sometimes have to, if you want, you have to deviate from your traditional rules in labor law, social law. And for instance, in Belgium, when they designed the unemployment scheme for self-employed, we have a kind of mini unemployment scheme for self-employed, they had to invent new rules specifically for the self-employed, which were completely different from the ones for the wage earners because they worked atypically. They worked not in the same way as the wage earners. So that's a bit what the traditional three layers of atypical work. Lately, and if you look at some reports of Eurofound and others, you see that apparently there is a kind of explosion of new atypical work forms. So the three traditional ones, part-time, fixed-term and self-employment, have been now circumvented by an endless number of new types of atypical work forms. And platform work is sometimes also labeled as one of those atypical work forms. Crowd work is then also being referred, crowd work as part of platform work or outside of platform work. Portfolio work is being mentioned, apprentices, freelance workers, they call it some marginal work, and so on and so forth. Now, we had a closer look at those atypical work forms, those new ones, and we based ourselves upon the report from Eurofound some 2-3 years ago, and we tried to find out what is different compared to the other traditional three ones. And most of the time what we found out was that they were a further combination of the existing three ones, that they were applying part-time and fixed term together. So it's actually not new. It is intensifying the existing atypical work forms in one work form. And I will give you one example here. I mean, if you look at crowd work, if you see the traditional elements of the traditional workers, which I've been mentioning before, well, crowd workers are not, you cannot tick many boxes of the traditional workers. They do not work very often indefinite. It's very little jobs, little tasks. They don't do it for one. They may do it full-time on a platform, and this beginning was interesting, but it's not full-time for one client or one provider. It's maybe full-time on the platform. Unless we would consider the platform to be the employer, then this line, of course, would become colored as well as for the other ones. So there you see the other atypical work forms which we have been looking at, and some parts which were showing elements of the traditional work, some parts were not showing elements of the traditional work. Portfolio workers, which were also very often present on platforms, but they are in another position because they have a kind of portfolio. They are designers, for instance, they are fashion people, they are skilled workers, and so on, and they are looked for their skills. And they are in a much stronger position. They sometimes refuse. They do it because they want to do it, and so on. Very often in extra time. Many of the portfolio workers work extra to their main job as a kind of extra income, whereas crowd workers, they're very often, it's a big crowd. They depend most of the time more upon platforms, at least from the data I could see, read, because we don't have so many data. Now, why is it relevant? Because why did we do so for all those atypical work forms? When it's deviating from the traditional work, when the element of traditional work is not there, then it may be that some of the laws designed around the traditional work will be problematic for them. For instance, if the full-time element is not present for the atypical worker, all social laws like pensions, which start from full-time work, will become problematic for those workers and will need some corrections in the laws. Otherwise, you risk that the protection will be low or so others and so forth. So that was for us a kind of indication why we did it so in our research. Comes then platform work, and I will give a definition of platform work immediately for our project. Is it really such a big issue for law? The last couple of years, 2-3 years. The number of meetings, conferences, projects on platform work, it exploded. But when you hear the data, for instance, 2 years ago, I still remember on the European Union, one of the conferences, that Eurofound was saying this platform work, it is extremely marginal, they said. It is 1.5% of the economically active population is working as a platform worker. It's marginal. And moreover, they said economically everything is going well. So what is the big fuss? That was one of the statements they were making. Okay, it's something new, it's evolving, and there may be some issues, and it's challenging some of the traditional systems, like social protection systems. But what are we talking about? We hardly can count them on one hand, and so on and so forth. That was a bit the main message. I had some reserves there. They said, well, how did you calculate your 1.5%? Because some of them don't consider them to be workers. And maybe they are not in your sample because they don't consider themselves to be workers, and hence they did not react. And there they had to acknowledge that maybe in the counting there may be some issues. Is it really an issue? Because as I mentioned, platform work in the most extreme is a kind of combination of and part-time and defined work and self-employment. And we know those things already for 30 years, and we know how more or less to address it. So now we have to address it in a combined manner. So from social law, maybe it's not a big issue. Yes and no, to some extent it's not a big issue. If you really go into the essence, again, it's part-time, fixed term, and self-employment, and we already have some tools, but there are some new challenges we noticed. And the first challenge, I think, it has to do with the tasks. It has been mentioned before already, the gigs, the little tasks, it's very little. I mean, part-time work, traditionally we think then of half-time work, so you get a kind of contract for half-time, or maybe one-third or whatever, but here we're talking about little tasks, gigs. It's micro. And how to deal with that? Because with pensions, those little micro tasks are very difficult to capture. Sometimes pensions are calculated in numbers of hours of working in countries, that you need to have to work so many hours a week. But here we're talking about little tasks, which are very difficult to calculate in hours. It's quite problematic for some extent. Another problematic issue is that sometimes those little tasks, a little amount of time, can generate big amounts of money. And we are not used to that in Social Security. We are used to 38 hours of week, 40 hours of week of work, and for that kind of hours of week you get that kind of amount of money, and with that kind of money you will get that kind of pension in the end of the day. And now suddenly it can be that, let's say in 5 minutes, you earn suddenly a disproportionate amount of money, and how to deal with that in Social Security. So it's indeed, well, upsetting a little bit the traditional approach of designing our social systems. I would go one step further. It's very hard to find out, and that's what the reason why my questions before to colleague Schneider. Are those activities work activities? Is it work? Now, I'm pretty sure that most of you have been very active on one or another platform without you noticing maybe that you were working. Were you working? For instance, I think you have been putting some reports on TripAdvisor or Booking.com or whatever to share your experiences in a certain hotel or restaurant or a place. Well, do you know that you take away the work from the person who traditionally was writing reports in the guide, the touristic guide, and he was going to eat in the restaurants or going to sleep in the hotels, and he was testing it out, and you had some French movies about him. That was his work, and he was earning income out of that. Now we do it, and we share it, because that was very often the idea of platforms, sharing. But is that work? It's an activity, you spend some time to, and sometimes you say, do I really have to do it? Okay, I will do it, and I will say a little word, and so on and so forth. Is it work? I don't think you consider that to be work yourself. You did not earn income, I guess, maybe indirectly, you can get some credits for it, I don't know. But it's not always easy to make that distinction. I mean, influencers, or people on social media, having a lot of followers. Sometimes they get money for that, big money for that, because many people follow them. So they get subsidies from companies to make sure that their clothes are somewhere being mentioned in the report. Is that work? It's definitely his income. And probably that person will use that income to live upon. But will that person consider that to be work? Is it important? Yes, it's important, because if they consider that to be work, they have to declare it. You have income declaration, you have tax, you have social security contributions. But if you yourself from the beginning, from the outset, don't consider that to be work, you will not have the inclination to report it to your authorities. It's not that you try to avoid the law. Some of them, of course, try to avoid the law, but sometimes you're even not aware that you're doing some activities. So it becomes, I mean, traditionally in social law, we had a huge problem, and that problem still exists, between who are the wage earners, who are the self-employed. That's also an issue for platform work. Eh? I mean, there are many case law on that. But we have a new problem coming up. When is an activity a professional activity, and when it's not a professional activity? And in Germany, it's an issue. In Belgium, it's an issue. In France, it's an issue, because most of our pension schemes, healthcare schemes, they are focused upon work-related activities. So the first element we have to know, is the activity work or is it not work? And then the second element, is it self-employed work or is it employee work, which is also an issue. That's about those gigs and the work. And then the third element, I think, which is challenging, is the geographical element, spreading. That was also the reason of my question of the sample. Is it German, the sample, or is it beyond? The potential here is enormous. Eh? You can have somebody behind the computer doing a little task, especially online. Offline, we can track them. Eh? They're biking here with Deliveroo on their back, or Uber Eats, and so on. We see them. They are not the most complicated cases, in my opinion, although most of the fuss is now about them in social law, whether wage earners, but that's not so complicated, I think. Much more complicated are online activities, where we don't have a clue where they are. I mean, they can do that job wherever. Here in Bremen, I'm here for 1.5 days. I can do some activities. I'm back tomorrow in Tilburg and I continue. I mean, look, where am I working? Is it important? Yes, it's important. Because in most of our systems, where you work, that's the place where you're socially protected. And it's already an issue for posted workers, people who for 2-3 days go to work somewhere and go back. Can you imagine if you have those little tasks and you do it in today here, tomorrow there, and so on? It's a major issue, and in Europe they don't know how to answer this issue for the moment. And then I even don't talk about the fact that the one who is asking you to do something is somewhere totally different, at a different place in the world, that the platform is located somewhere else, or having its main seat somewhere else, that the server is at. As to the control, the things we have been discussing already before, it becomes rather problematic to impose some of the legislation and so on, and it's more challenging than it goes beyond the European Union. And even though you can say they should be in our system, the next question will come there, how to make that they will pay the necessary duties and that they will obey by law and so on and so forth. And that's quite a challenge. And there you see that the intensification of those atypical workers becomes a problem. Okay, for our research, we had a major problem. The concept of platform worker does not exist legally, at least not in social law, except now for France and Belgium. It's not a legal concept. In our social laws, in the pension, it's not the platform worker is the following person. Nevertheless, in our research, we wanted to find out, is the platform worker protected? Does he enjoy or she enjoy protection for social security? And what kind of protection? But we had to track that person down in one way or another, and how to define and how to make sure that we were comparing the same person across the systems we were looking upon. So we made an own definition, what you see here, and I will go very quickly. I think, as you did as well, what was interesting was especially the ones who were getting income or remuneration, because you have many platforms. You can also have sharing platforms. We were not interested so much in those sharing platforms where we were sharing things and so on. Unless it was an economic sharing, of course. It's about income. So that's especially a focus group. There are people selected online. From a pool of workers, I don't have to explain that too much. Through the intermediation of a platform. A platform, you have a huge variety of platforms. I will not go too much into detail here because I'm pretty much sure you know very much about it, even more than I do. But I mean, you have online, you have offline platforms, you have platforms, as it was mentioned, which are simply a marketplace, do not intervene too much. They simply make sure that providers and consumers do meet each other. But others are monitoring very much and steering very much the action on the income. I mean, with Uber, you're not free, of course, to set your rates. On the satisfaction rates, on the how to behave and so on. So that we left open, so we have that multitude, but we find some differentiations, and I think in a further run, we would like to find out whether there are some typologies. Again, that was also one of the questions that I was asking before. Personally, so it's not a company doing the service on demand, so the other side is asking, so you do it. Short-term task, the gigs, for different persons or companies. So from the taking side, the ones consuming, we don't mind so much whether it's a person or a company, but the one who's providing it's personally, so that's not a company. But especially in exchange of income, that was rather crucial for us. So that's a bit in a kind of a slide. And there you see very much a triangular relation again of what you also will see and notice in agency work. It comes very close to agency work, and some of the colleagues, especially of labor law, they try to make the comparison between agency work and platform work and to find out whether the labor law protection and social law protection labor law could be a kind of reference in for the labor law and social protection for platform workers. But you see here the triangular relation. And that was a little bit the definition of the person who we were singling out. And then the next question was, is that person being protected? So we are now looking at some systems in Germany, in France, UK, Belgium, Netherlands, and I show you some of the slides, and I will not go too much into detail, but I will say some things. So we are dealing here with a platform worker who is raising some income out of activities he or she is performing on a platform. Where does he or she end up in the social protection system? Because most of our countries do not have specific schemes for them alone. They either will end up as an employee or a self-employed, if it's considered to be work. If it's not considered to be work, it can also be resident, but I will not go there too much into detail. I will keep it here simple. Either it's an employee or a self-employed. Do know that for the moment, and some of you will know, that there is a multitude of cases now going on the question, the Uber driver or Amazon Turk provider, is he an employee or is he a self-employed? And it's amazing to see how the outcomes, how different they are. I mean, in the Netherlands, it was a this time last year, they had their first case on Deliveroo driver, and the Deliveroo driver was considered to be a self-employed person. So the judge in Amsterdam said, if I look at the criteria, the ones I was referring, it's clear that he's working on his own and he's self-employed. Whereas the driver was saying, no, I'm bound by Deliveroo, by that and that and that. I'm not free. No, the judge said. Some months later, the trade union launched a new case on a totally different aspect. And there, another judge in Amsterdam was saying, no, they are employees, they are wage earners. And now we have a third case. And the same in France, the same actually in US, the same in UK. It's going in diverse directions. So this battle is now being fought out whether they are employees or self-employed and so on. So sometimes they're considered to be an employee, sometimes they're considered to be a self-employed. Now, if they are considered to be employee, you very often hear a kind of hooray, especially of the ones who are fighting for the social rights. They say, yes, we won the battle, and now labor law and social protection law will become applicable, because for the self-employed, their protection is very weak, very often no labor law, and social protection very, very marginal. Look also at the German case, where most of the self-employed are not fully protected, or only partially protected, or not protected at all. But you have to pay attention. And for instance, in Germany, I think you're very familiar with that. Even if you're protected as an employee, as a wage earner for Social Security, when your work is done in an irregular way, irregular in the sense when your income is low or quite low, you will not be fully protected. And then you see the income thresholds, of course, or the duration thresholds. If your work is not continuously being performed a certain amount of days, suddenly other rules start to apply. And what you will see on the chart is when you see the little bird, it means that you're protected for that risk, old age or invalidity or contributory unemployment or maternity, paternity. If you see the crosses, you're not protected. And if you see voluntarily, you may be protected if you wish so, if you want to enter within some restrictions. And then you see the more irregular, and that's very often for platform workers because they work in an irregular way. And therefore, I also had the findings of the full-time present and so on were very interesting. Because it could have an effect, and also the income they were gaining could have an effect. The more irregular it becomes, the more crosses you will see, and the lower the protection will be. And that's even more the case for the self-employed in Germany and the other countries. The more irregular the activities are, the more voluntarily or the more crosses you will see. I will give you one example for France, for instance, and then I will stop with those charts. In France, you have a kind of the same. They can either be employees or self-employed. Many of the platform workers are here in the micro-entrepreneur, in the small entrepreneur, the small businessman, as they call them. France did something specific for them, for all small businessmen. The issue in France is the following. If you have low income out of self-employed activities, you're having a hard time in France because you have to start to pay contributions from a kind of minimum income. It's depending upon the activity, either 30,000 a year or 80,000 a year. So even if you earn less, you start from there, which was, of course, killing off some of the businesses. If you have platform worker with some little amounts of income of salary, they cannot generate that income. So what did France do? They lowered the thresholds. They said, we allow you to be a self-employed, even if you don't earn that amount of money, and you can start to pay on the basis of the real income you earned and not from the 80,000 or the 30,000 or thresholds. That's nice, but at the same time, they were skipping some of the protection, and you see that at the end of the day, most of the platform workers are here, but only with a very partial protection. That's a kind of picture we see in most of the countries. It's not typical for France or Germany. We see the same in the UK. We see the same in the Netherlands and so on. And it has to do with their irregular work. Now, for social protection, we see three major challenges which have to be addressed in our systems. The first has to do with work. What is work and irregular work? The pattern of most of those people is rather irregular. They don't work from 9 to 5 in a very irregular pattern, not at least for one client. And if your systems like the pensions and so on are designed in that way, or the contribution levy is designed in that way, you have a problem and you have to adapt your systems if you want to accompany those people into your systems. The employer is an issue. Who is the employer? And so if you consider the platform worker to be an employee, but who is then the employer? Question mark. So you will have to adapt your systems there as well. And then a third one is income instability, low income and minimum thresholds which are being used. I gave you an example there. And that's quite an issue, I think, what to do with the, I mean, apparently quite many of them have a very low income, what to do with your social security. The worst thing you can do is to allow them in on the basis of that low income and to give them high benefits in the end, because then that's not sustainable for your system. But some systems are doing that. They say they are welcome. They have to pay low contributions. We don't care. They run into the system. We are inclusive. They pay low contributions on the low income, and we guarantee them some minimum benefits later on, which are higher than the income they declared before. That's not good for the stability of a system. But the alternative is we guarantee them low benefits. That's not good either, because then you will have to correct through poverty schemes and social assistance schemes. So that's a kind of big issue where most of the countries are now struggling with. And you see in the UK, for instance, they more or less decide to give subsidies on top of the irregular income, irregular in the sense of the low income. So they are subsidizing those forms of work, which of course is very nice for the platforms and the commissioners, because it's cheap labor which is being provided. And that's quite an issue. By law, you cannot address this issue. This is more by social policy. But I think for social security, you have to be quite consequent. Now, to close off, I mean, out of the work we have been doing, we see three major challenges or three major conclusions. One is, and that's something I did not address here because it's rather legal, technical, it is possible to introduce them into your systems, platform workers. It is. But you have to focus first upon to what extent do they deviate from the traditional worker. If that's clear to you, if you understand how they work, you can adapt your systems. You can make an unemployment scheme for self-employed, and you can make an unemployment scheme for platform work if you want. If you understand how they work, and if you're open and willing to deviate from the traditional worker, but therefore you first have to understand how they work. That's a kind of legal approach. Second, I think there is an evolution going on, at least in social security. I think more and more we should move away on trying to protect income out of work. Work was always very important. I think we have to protect income. All people want to earn income to live their life upon. Social protection tries to make sure that when you lose your income, you're protected. Now we still have that element of work in between. I don't know whether we can continue to keep it up as an important element in the design of our social security systems. I think income protection is more important. As I said before, the influencer or the person working online, he or she is earning income, not always aware that he or she is working, but income is being earned and income is to be protected. And that element of work will become, I think, less important in the design of our systems. Remains the issue of marginal income and marginal income out of work. What to do with that? I think here the best approach is to be coherent. What is not to be recommended is to allow to have them including in your systems with low contributions and to give high benefits. You have to be coherent, transparent, or equivalent. But to some extent, you will have to support some of the activities in some way. And that's quite an issue. How far to go with the social support? Because if you do not pay attention, you're giving subsidies to some platforms, giving them the possibility to make use or abuse of cheap labor, which we are subventioning. So we don't have to step into that trap. So that's a bit the research we are now doing in Tilburg and in Leuven and the first outcomes we have in social security. Some of the outcomes are rather similar of 20, 25 years ago when we did a study on self-employment, but there are some new challenges which popped up because of that rather extreme, atypical kind of platform work. Thank you very much.
So I'm pretty sure this presentation has raised a couple of questions, and so the floor is open to the audience if there are any questions.
It's Thank you very much for the talk. You had a slide where you showed different figures regarding relationship between employee and employers for different type of works. I don't understand the crowd work types. Would you please explain it more? I couldn't understand which information this figure gives. Yeah, here, yes, this one. Only the crowd workers. Yeah.
So here are the elements which traditionally you find for a traditional worker, and which are important for labor law and social security law, because most of the time those elements have been influencing the type of protection. And what we simply did with some of these are simply six, but we did it with more, with some of the atypical workers like crowd workers, we tried to figure out which of those traditional elements in the normal labor relation are present for those crowd workers. And here in the extreme, we found none. So it means that they are at a very extreme outlier, if I can say so, from the traditional worker. And it means that the challenges to design your labor law and your social security law can be more challenging. In the same way, you could say that the real self-employed, in the most extreme way, if I can say so, having many clients and so on and so forth, would also be in that kind of position. But some others are atypical, like economically dependent self-employed, to give you another example. This is a self-employed person with one boss, well, with one commissioner. He only has one client. And that shows that economically he's depending upon that one client. And then you see suddenly that some elements of the traditional worker, the traditional wage earner, start to show up with that economically dependent self-employed. Or here's the owner-manager of an own company. That's, I think, an interesting case. You have some self-employed who organize themselves in an own legal company. And they work within their own company as a self-employed. So they are a kind of single company. And they give themselves an income, a wage, which is completely fictitious. So it's a self-employed bargaining with his own company, asking to set a wage. What kind of wage do you want? So he's, but on the basis of that wage, he's raising his contribution. So here you see that some of the elements you come close to, and so on. So that was the chart about, and it helped us to get some insight on what are the elements we have to pay attention in the laws and legislation, and where the legislator may have intervened to adapt to the own situation of those people. That was a bit of chart. Yeah.
Thank you for your presentation. It seems to me that you're looking at a 21st century type of work arrangement with based on late 19th century, first 20th century kind of legal structure, which is sort of in your language a bit of bricolage, isn't it? So I was wondering whether what you think of a basic income, and unconditional or a negative income tax, it would get away with unemployment insurance, would get away with pension funds to some extent. Wouldn't that be much nicer?
Yeah, that's something I did not, well, actually I touched upon it when I was talking about subsidizing work. I did not, in some other presentations, I directly raised them. As to the first, you're completely right, and that's what I think the wrong approach or wrong policy I noticed in some of the states, countries, policymakers, trade unions, employers, and so on. So the first thing you see is that in the battle, if I would call it a battle, right, the fourth industrial revolution, they say, well, let us qualify that kind of work as employees. And so that's now, this time of the year, it's going on very much in most of the countries. It's the battle of qualification, the battle to have them qualified as employees, as wage earners, and then everything will be solved. That's a bit the approach you see now. And every time again, when there's a case, it's like a football game. Eh? When there is a case in front of the court and the judge decides this is an employee, you hear the cheer saying, yes, we won. They are considered to be employees. Now we can start to apply labor law and we can start to apply social security and everything will be solved. Which I don't think so. I think we will have to adapt also the labor law as such intrinsically, and the social laws intrinsically, to their kind of way of working. Otherwise, it will not work, it will not function. Some types of work it may function, but some types of work it may not function. So that's a bit the call we are doing, and that's what we try to figure out and to get on table, is to what extent is it possible to design social security in an appropriate way to their ways of working. And that's something we did in the past for the self-employed, and we found that it's possible. But you have to think out of the box. Maybe for some risks you have to accept that those risks are not to be protected anymore, and so on. And the same is taking place for platform work. Be it that the question could be that maybe it's impossible. I mean, some months ago I had a discussion with somebody, and they said maybe we have to acknowledge this is the end of labor law. Yes. Yeah? And this is the end of social security law. Huh? That's what the person was saying. Those are old school things from the 19th century. And what we try to do is to squeeze that on those people. I do not follow that completely, that logic. And then comes in the element of let us go for basic income. Huh? Well, I'm not personally so much in favor of the basic income idea for several reasons. I mean, the first one, but that's maybe because I'm old school and conservative and traditional, because in traditional social law protection, but also in societies, there has been traditionally a cornerstone of work ethos. If you look at labor law, but especially social security, the whole design is not only about rights, it's also about duties. And the duties was very much work-related, the work ethos. In employment, in working capacity, for instance, the idea is to bring you back at work, or at least to activate you, or at least to, and so on, which is absent in basic income. And already from a kind of design, I have some doubts about that. Secondly, but I'm not economically, financially too strongly developed, but I understood also from some colleagues from the economics that, financially speaking, it depends of course where you put the income level of basic income. It's very hard to have it organized. Recently in the Netherlands they had some research, big research from colleagues from the Faculty of Economics from Belgium and the Netherlands, and they had some tests and so on. And at a certain moment they said, "We stop." They did not even finalize it. They stopped. They said, "It's insane. You cannot finance it." I have to say I did not read it completely, but that was the message. Thirdly, and this is more political or ideologically, the basic income is something which was once launched by one of the colleagues from the University of Leuven, the French-speaking University of Leuven, Van Parijs. And it's a thing which comes and goes. I think it's now the third time when we are debating it very strongly. And it's the third time I notice that we have been debating, so I'm getting old, I have a feeling. So it will go down, I think, as well. And now suddenly I found that from the liberal right and the left, liberal left, they were finding each other. Traditionally it was something from the left which was launched to have more redistribution and more equivalence and so on. But now suddenly I noticed that from the liberal right there was a very strong support for that basic income. Silicon Valley suddenly said, "We should launch basic income." I said, "Why? Where did they? And then the question came, at what level? Yeah, we don't know, but not too high, of course. Of course not too high. Give them a little bit of petty money, like you see in the UK with some of the persons on unemployment, some unconditional income, but not too high. And then you have a fantastic crowd who can do all kinds of little jobs for which you don't have to pay any taxes or contributions, and for which their living is being subsidized by a solidarity group, a state. Why in heaven's name should I subsidize, or should my state subsidize, or should my collectivity subsidize companies?" And so on. Yet they were finding each other there. And that's more political, ideological. Fourthly, if you look in the European Union, basic income. I mean, there is only one way out. It's European basic income, not a national one, because then you're doing very strange things. At what level? That's a very hard discussion. Relative, absolute harmonization and so on. So even as an idea, I don't like it, but also in some practicalities, I have some problems with it.
Yeah, thank you very much for... Okay, so thank you very much for sharing, especially the discussion with us. I was thinking all the time, is this like a déjà vu? Why? Because we had similar discussions around data protection. until we finally realized that there is no way with our legal tradition to deal with data protection on the internet. That's why for the first time, to the best of my knowledge, and I'm not a law expert, right, we launched an entirely different logic of how to regulate data protection in the EU, and we changed the underlying principles, and now the world looks at us as being very innovative when it comes to regulating things on the web. I'm wondering, shouldn't we do the same here? And the principles would be very easy. The first one is follow the money, right? So wherever you work and you get income, social security is applied. Second thing is, what is it that you want to protect? You want to protect citizens of the EU, no matter where they are. So, okay, every time someone with an EU passport is working, he has to be treated by that logic. So I'm just doing the analogy, and out of the blue, 85% to 90% of the problems that I see would go away. So my simple provocative question would be, why don't we do it? Are we too stupid?
Thank you very much for this comment, and I would say to a large extent, if not fully, I agree. But what my first call was, we should move away from that labor thing, income. I mean, I'm not talking about labor law. I always laugh at my colleagues of labor law. I'm very sorry for the ones who are sitting here. Very often I say to them, you're still in the Middle Ages. In Social Security, at least, we already protect freelancers and self-employed and whatever. You're still in your wage earners situation. For social protection, what do we want to protect at the end of the day? It's income loss. And labor is a kind of mean way. It was, for many decades, the gateway to income. I think my parents, and even me to some extent, my generation, working from 9 to 5, hard working, that was the way of raising your income. And that was also the model. It was also the model of a welfare state. And that's the reason why labor was also, I think, because of the fact that for decades we had some stability here, all kinds of incomes have been generated and all kinds of income development have been generated. It's not only out of labor. So I think the focus should be much more upon income raising and income protection, whatever the source of income is. And there indeed, if you follow some sound logics, follow the money, you can start and so on and so forth. And that I follow. To your last element, we ourselves in Leuven, but that's already 30 years ago, once we launched the idea of a European system. At that time, it was simply for the moving workers, but we have been developing, and very strangely enough, the last 2-3 years, it's a very old idea. Again, this was put on the shelf, and they said, can you explain again that idea of the European insurance for the, and so on. And we think that for the very mobile worker, and the platform worker is a European worker, even global worker, you can say, what sense does it make to try to track down where, on which location that person is physically standing? It's European work. We should be proud to some extent that some people work in a European manner. I mean, many of the researchers work in a European manner, if not a global manner. So why not having that initiative on the European level? That's something we launched in another time, and then it was for other type of people when platform work was not present, but there you see the connection again. But if we do so every time again, we get a response, very nice idea, very bright, but impossible to implement. We don't have the power to do so, and blah, 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 and so on and so forth. But maybe with this, when this we may grow, that's, and maybe the mind setting may be changed, but that's definitely some of the elements we would like to put on table again. Why not moving away from the traditional way and come? And I do agree, I think we need out-of-the-box solutions, not starting from the traditional work.
So thank you very much, Paul. I would also have a couple of more questions, but I think we are running a bit out of time. And so I think we have to move on to the next presentation.